Looking back, it's been a year since I did the walkthrough and review to one of the greatest Neo Geo games, Metal Slug. All 7 parts were meant to be posted on Veterans Day, but surprisingly, Nightwing01 posted a Retro Monday of Metal Slug at exactly the same time I did. Unfortunately, I was not too happy with the end result of the videos. I idiotically filmed my DVD recording on my computer monitor. Now that I have a video editing software, I have been able to make proper videos. So, enough with the history lesson about me and my videos, let's dive into Metal Slug once again. In the year 1996, a company named the Nazca Corporation, a company most known for Neo Turf Masters at the time, broke up from IREM, the same company known for great games like R-Type, Gunforce, and Hammer and Harry, all classic games. Except Deadly Towers. After the fallout between Nazca and IREM, Nazca began production on Metal Slug. However, at the time of production, the arcades were suffering heavily from the lack of consumers due to the dawn of new consoles such as the Sony PlayStation, the Sega Saturn, and Nintendo 64. Nazca took this criticism seriously and decided to release Metal Slug in limited quantities. Unfortunately, much to their surprise, Metal Slug got praise. So much, in fact, it was released on not only the Neo Geo line, but it found its way onto the Sega Saturn as well as the Sony PlayStation, with extra features I will talk about later.
Mission 1, start!
Metal Slug is a run-and-gun game where you take on the role of Marco Rossi, he's player 1, and Tarma Robin III, if a second player joins in. And their mission is to bring back World Order, which has been overthrown by General Donald Devil Rebirth Morton and the Rebellion Army. It's up to Marco Rossi and Tarma Robin III, Peregrine Falcons, who are a branch of the regular army, now decimated as a result of the coup d'état, to rescue POWs, wipe out the Rebellion Army, and take back the secret weapon the regular army has been laboring over before the war broke out. And for the game's namesake, the
Metal Slug!
Mission 2, start!
If you play Contra, you'll know how the controls work. You obviously use the joystick to move your characters. You press A to shoot, press B to jump, and an extra feature some run-and-gun games don't have is the use of grenades. You fire your grenades with C. When you're in the Metal Slug, the controls are about the same, but with two adjustable and powerful Gatling guns that fire in 8 directions. The slug bullets don't have much range nor bounce like the grenades. The Metal Slug can also take some punishment. After 3 hits, that's it. You have no other choice but to escape the tank before it explodes. And speaking of explodes, you can also perform a rush kamikaze at the expense of your tank. If you want some advanced techniques, I'll teach you some. You can use grenades in your Metal Slug by holding down and C. You can also bounce on tanks without taking damage. Just don't get cocky.
Mission 3, start!
Now, the object of each mission is simple. Kill, 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 kill. Along the way, you'll meet POWs that will give you weapons or random crap that does nothing but increase your point total for a high score. But like in boot camp, your mama isn't here to kiss your bruises. You will get killed by infantrymen of the Rebellion Army, run over by tanks, shot down, bombed, electrocuted, drowned, stabbed. Well, you get the idea. Kill or be killed.
Mission 4, start!
At the end of each mission, you will fight a boss, either a crashed naval plane that pulls a shoop de whoop, a rail tank that kills two dummies who obviously fail at life because they didn't get out of the way, a mega tank that hogs up the bottom half of the screen, Shu and Karn, two super tanks who later on become sort of mini-bosses of Stage 5, and speaking of which, what the heck is that thing? An attack carrier of some type. Out of all the war machines I've seen in my life, I have no idea what the heck that thing is. You also encounter General Morden twice in the game. Once as a boss at the end of Mission 2, who gets away. Got it. And another time on the final mission, who attempts to kill you, but you are rescued by an undersea boot. I'm not going to spoil the end of the game until the review is over.
Mission 5, start!
As good as Metal Slug was, it does have its fair share of problems. Mainly, its length and overall difficulty are my main complaints. The game is short, mainly comprising of 6 missions. That's it. Unless you're playing the Neo Geo CD, PlayStation, or Sega Saturn versions, there are some extra features like the combat school, extra missions within the main missions, and an unlockable art gallery. The difficulty is fair, but it can have its fair share of quarter muncher moments. Another problem is the bosses. More specifically, the third mission's mini-boss, the game's mid-boss, if you will. Sergeant Alan O'Neill. He is a random attacker, giving you little to no strategy on how to properly kill this guy. He is also annoying, constantly saying idiotic one-liners.
Oh boy!
He is equally as annoying as Awesome Possum. He just doesn't know when to shut his face. This also brings up another point. Notice how Alan gets redder with each blow delivered. That is to indicate damage done to him. That's a good thing. Ironically, the boss in Mission 3 doesn't know how to die properly. It literally takes a long time for the boss to push up daisies. And to make matters worse, there is no indication to see if the Sob is even close to dying. Mission 1's boss is close to dying if the dude on the balcony blows up and it begins to fire its lasers. Mission 2's boss is close to dying when it starts to steam up and fumes like crazy. Mission 4's bosses are more like enemies than bosses. At least Mission 5's boss indicates it's ready to move on to the second phase as its tires get flat. Mission 3's boss just sucks. I literally feel like the battle goes on for half a century, which is annoying.
Mission 6, start!
The game does have a wonderful personality. Morbid, but hilarious. It's like watching a Monty Python cartoon. It's a personality-filled quest for the Holy Grail, complete with morbid yet satisfying moments. And speaking of Holy Grail, this game can be very expensive. I would recommend the game, but it is one of the rarest games in existence. The Japanese version of this game is so rare, it can actually reach to prices as extraordinary as $1,300. The USA version, however, can reach up to $2,500. $2,500? Really? That's beyond astronomical! Nazca must have taken that near fall of the arcades too literally. I mean, it's just mind-boggling. You're better off getting the Sega Saturn, PlayStation, or Anthology versions. You could also pick it up as a part of SNK Arcade Classics Volume 1 for the PS2, PSP, or Wii. Virtual Console works too. You could also pick it up as a part of the Neo Geo Station on the PlayStation 3. And Neo Geo CD. Another great aspect of Metal Slug are its screaming soldiers. In my opinion, those soldiers' screams never seem to get old. Why? I don't know why. I'm a sick, sick freak, aren't I? The game also has some cool little secrets. Take this scenario for example. Just as the undersea boot reaches land and you jump off immediately and land into the shores of the final stretch before the final boss, you'll earn a crap ton of points. Also, Mission 3 has this porta potty which only exists for you to blow up. Inside, you will see the guy taking a dump and then hides in the porta potty. Almost reminds me a lot like that one scene in Schindler's List, but I don't want to calculate. There's also one instance where if you dive into the waters of the first portions of Mission 2, a big old billy bass comes up to eat you, and you will see either Marco or Tarma struggling to get out of the mouth, just to sink back into the cold waters and to lose one of your precious extra lives needed to beat the game and survive uncommon soldiers. Isn't it obvious? This game is the purebred definition of an arcade classic. It has humor, though it is gory and morbid, personality, and secrets. It has infinite replay value and has aged incredibly. The graphics are awesome for 16-bit, though claimed to be 24-bit, arcade standards. Yet even to this day, they stand up to the test of time. This game's grade remains an A-. It has only one minor problem, but the game will make for a fun afternoon.